Hello everybody, my name's Terry, I'm the Bored Modeler, and this is the HE-70 German passenger aircraft by ICM in 1 to 70 second scale. This is what I'm going to be reviewing in this episode, so let's get the box open, take a look at the parts inside, and then let's get started. Let's start by flipping open the lid of the box and taking a look at the plastic parts we get in the kit. As you can see, we've got two sprues of grey plastic parts and one sprue of clear parts for the windows, packaged in two resealable bags. That's a nice touch, by the way. Being able to close up the bag when you're taking a break means there's less of a chance that you'll lose small parts. As for the parts themselves, well, they're certainly worth protecting, because the level of detail on them is stunning. ICM reckons this kit is the most precise model of the HE-70 ever moulded, and the parts in this kit certainly seem to back that up. Details such as the internal rib structure showing through the fabric wings and the flush rivets on the metal fuselage have been moulded beautifully, especially at this small scale. And the clear parts too, despite being a bit on the thick side, are beautifully transparent and nicely detailed. Apart from those beautiful plastic bits, you also get an instructions booklet, with an absolutely essential parts diagram on the front, some 3D renders depicting construction stages in the middle, and a paint chart at the back. You also get a double-sided paint diagram for the two decal options. It's printed in colour, which is odd, considering the aircraft is basically painted in greyscale. Anything else? Oh yes, the sheet of decals, with options for two Lufthansa planes. And that's everything you get in the box. Overall, I'm pretty impressed with what I saw, and I can't wait to get started. So, let's get to building then, shall we? As you'd expect from pretty much every aircraft kit, the cockpit was the first part that needed to be assembled. I started out by painting all the necessary cockpit parts in RLM-02. Well, a mix of Tamiya Sky and flat black that approximated the greenish-grey colour I saw in reference photos, at least. I then started assembly by gluing the seat into the cockpit and simulated worn paint by dabbing on some flat aluminium using the end of a sponge. After the paint was dry, I glued in the rudder pedals, and then I glued together the tiny control column. It's worth noting that, from here on in, the parts diagram on the front of the instructions is pretty much essential. There are no part numbers on the sprues or on the parts themselves, so check back to the diagram frequently to make sure you've got the right part before you start cutting and gluing. After I finished assembling the control column, I glued it into the cockpit tub. After that, I added this box. I'm not too sure what it is or where it goes, and the instructions weren't too clear on its exact location either, so I attached it where I thought it fitted best. Hopefully I'm right, because now that the model's done, I can't exactly go back in and change it. Anyway, that's it for the small and beautifully detailed cockpit this model has. Let's move on to the passenger cabin now, and start by sanding out the ejector pin mark on the cabin floor. Once that was all cleaned up, I gave the interior parts a coat of XF50 field blue. You'll have to find some reference photos online for the interior, because the only colour listed in the instructions is black for the seats. And once the paint had dried, I realised I'd forgotten something. Door. See, ICM makes two versions of this aircraft, a military plane and a passenger plane. Obviously, the military version doesn't have a passenger cabin, and therefore the passenger door isn't moulded onto the kit's fuselage. So, in order to make this a passenger plane, I had to cut a hole in the fuselage and attach the door that was provided on the clear parts sprue, a task which turned out to be easier said than done. ICM does provide a moulded guideline on the interior of the fuselage to help you with your cutting, but the line isn't very distinct, the plastic fuselage is really thick, and it's easy to make a mistake if you're not careful. As a result, it took me more than half an hour of drilling, sanding, cutting and test fitting before I had a hole big enough to put the door in. I would have much rather had the door already moulded into the fuselage, but I guess the passenger version's a bit of a niche subject, so I can see why ICM did it the way they did, even though it adds a lot more time and effort to the build process than some people might be willing or able to put in. Well, after all that hard work, all that was left to do was spread some white glue on the inside of the fuselage and then slide the door into place. Well, that and repaint the inside of the fuselage, of course. Quite done with painting the interior of the fuselage just yet. As you can see, the real Heinkel HE70 had a two-tone interior, with a lighter colour on the ceiling. Now, obviously the photo's in black and white, and despite all the searching I did, I couldn't find any colour versions. So I sort of guessed, and painted the cabin ceiling in deck tan. I'm still not sure what colour it actually was, but this combination looked pretty good. Not that you'll be able to see the cabin ceiling once the fuselage is closed up, but at least I'm happy with it. Anyway, while the fuselage dries, let's finish off the interior. I'll start that off by gluing the cockpit into the forward wing spar, or attaching the forward wing spar onto the cockpit, whichever you prefer. This sub-assembly was then glued to the cockpit's rear bulkhead, which also forms the front wall of the passenger cabin, and after I'd finished painting the passenger seats in gloss black, I finished building the interior by gluing all the sub-assemblies in place on the lower wing. I also added the landing gear bays on the wings. Overall, I'm quite pleased with how the interior of the Heinkel went together. The parts are beautifully detailed, and almost all of them fitted together perfectly. Apart from some slight confusion with the instructions, the kit was shaping up to be pretty good. Until, that is, I got to the cabin windows. Every single one of the five windows that had to be attached to the fuselage was ever so slightly too big for the hole it was meant to fit in. On the plus side, that meant there wasn't much risk of the windows falling out of the fuselage after they were put in place. Unfortunately, the actual putting in place was one of the toughest parts of the build. As you can see, I resorted to force to get the windows into the fuselage, but if you're building the kit, I'd highly recommend sanding instead. That way, you'll ensure that the windows fit properly, and you don't run the risk of breaking things like the fuselage, the windows. After I'd finished my battle with the windows, I celebrated my momentous victory by painting the Heinkel's instrument panel. Seeing as it's clear, I decided to try a new technique. I covered up the dials using masking solution, sprayed the front in RLM-02, and then painted the back of the instrument panel in flat black. After a bit of touching up, the results looked pretty good, even though they're completely invisible in the Heinkel's tiny cockpit. While I waited for the instrument panel to dry, I attached the right-hand fuselage half onto the interior sub-assembly. The join between the fuselage and wing is kind of vague, if I'm honest, and it's a bit tricky to get everything aligned, but after a little bit of pushing, everything seemed to fit together well. Well, until I started gluing the bulkheads into the fuselage, that is. These parts, especially the forward one and the nose, followed the example of the windows in being a bit too big for the spots they were supposed to go in. As you'll see later, this caused some pretty major alignment issues with the fuselage and wings. Anyway, after I'd wrestled the bulkheads into position, I added the instrument panel, and then took some beauty shots of the Heinkel's interior. Take a good look, because this is probably the last time any of this wonderful detail will be clearly visible. Once the glue dried, I closed up the interior for good by attaching the left-hand side of the fuselage. Remember how I said those internal bulkheads were slightly too large? Well, here's the result. If you squeeze the fuselage together on top, you get a massive gap at the bottom. I tried to minimize the gap by applying more glue and using electrical tape to pull the parts together, but that wasn't going to close it up completely. One thing's for certain, I'm going to be spending a lot of time filling and sanding on this model before it's ready to paint. After giving the glue a couple of days to dry, I removed the tape to reveal that, unfortunately, the gaps were still very much there. That said though, there were a few more parts I wanted to attach before I broke out the putty and sandpaper. First off, because this is the airliner version, I had to attach this streamlined fairing behind the cockpit. That covers up the hole where the rear seat gunner sits on the military version. Next to go in were the exhaust pipes. These seemed to be a bit too long compared to my reference photos, but that was easy enough to fix. I simply pushed them in halfway and used extra glue to reinforce the joint so that they stayed in place. Once the exhausts were firmly in place and the glue had dried, I added the engine cover, and then got to work on the wings. Assembling the wings is somewhat convoluted to say the least, and the instructions don't go into much detail, so here's how I went about it. First, you have to add this brace. It fits into this hole in the center of the lower wing. While that's drying, go back to the fuselage subassembly and glue the top wing section onto the wing root. Then, once that's secure, glue the bottom wing onto the top wing. The parts themselves go together pretty well, with only minor gaps around the edges, but I do reckon the instructions could have been a lot more thorough as to how to assemble them. Assembling the tail surfaces was another place where the ambiguous instructions caused a bit of trouble for me. As you can see here, I attached the elevators, then the rudder, and then the tail cone. That resulted in some large gaps, and me knocking the rudder off the model while gluing everything in place. If you're building this kit, I'd recommend attaching the rudder last. It's still going to be a tight fit, but at least there's going to be less risk of you breaking something. Before attaching the canopy to the aircraft, I noticed that it was a bit too long for its intended position. That's because the canopy is shared between the civil and military versions of this kit, and the extra length is necessary to cover the radio operator's position on the reconnaissance plane. This, unfortunately, wasn't mentioned in the instructions, but it was a simple enough fix, and once I cut the back off, the canopy fitted pretty much perfectly. I took the canopy off again to mask it, and then attached it more permanently with white glue. With that done, I had most of the major parts of the airframe assembled. That meant I could now start the long process of filling and sanding, and remove, or at least minimize, the many gaps present on the model. That also means it's time for the obligatory historical montage, where I use information about the real aircraft as a hopefully entertaining distraction during a rather dull spot in the video. So, let's start right at the beginning of the HE-70's story then, right back in the early 1930s, when Deutsche Lufthansa, the German national airline, issued a design request for a fast mail plane to be used on intercity routes. The Heinkel company responded to this request by creating a streamlined monoplane, with elliptical wings and retractable landing gear, both highly innovative features at the time. One of the project's leaders was the engineer Siegfried Gunther, who, along with his brother Walter, had helped to pioneer the use of elliptical wings on high-speed aircraft. In addition to its advanced aerodynamics, the Heinkel design was made of lightweight alloys and powered by a BMW V12 engine. In 1932, when the plane first took to the air, these design elements combined to make it one of the fastest aircraft in the world, and allowed the plane to set 8 world airspeed records in test flights throughout the year. The HE-70, now nicknamed the Blitz due to its high speed, joined the Lufthansa fleet in 1933. The plane initially operated on 4 routes, connecting Berlin with Frankfurt, Hamburg and Cologne, and providing a rapid service between Cologne and Hamburg. The next year, it would also go into service between Berlin and the Spanish city of Seville as the first leg of Lufthansa's service to South America. Despite its high speed, though, the HE-70 never really succeeded as an airliner. It could only carry 5 passengers in relatively cramped conditions, and contemporary multi-engine designs like the Douglas DC-2 or Lockheed Electra could come close to matching its speed while carrying a far higher payload. However, the Blitz's impact on aviation didn't end when the 10 planes in Lufthansa service were withdrawn in 1937. The wing design used by the Blitz was also used in the Heinkel HE-100 and HE-112 fighters, and the aerodynamic elliptical wing shape influenced that of the Japanese Val dive bomber and the Supermarine Spitfire from Britain. The HE-70s themselves weren't done yet either, as the Luftwaffe snapped up the fast airliners and took them to Spain, now carrying guns and bombs, for the Spanish Civil War. But that's another story, possibly for another model, who knows. And anyway, my many sessions of filling and sanding now had the model looking less like a loosely organised collection of parts, and more like a complete Heinkel HE-70. Except for one thing, the windows. Because of their tight fit, they didn't quite go all the way in. That meant that they stuck out noticeably from the model's surface, and kind of detracted from the aircraft's sleek aerodynamic lines. And that had to be fixed. How? By sanding, of course. I started off my sanding blitzkrieg with 600 grit sandpaper. That's intended to get the windows level with the fuselage. After that, I switched to 1200 grit sandpaper, to unify everything and smooth out the surface a little more. Once I'd finished my 1200 grit round, the windows were flush with the fuselage, but completely opaque. In order to fix that, I'd have to abandon the hardware store sandpaper and turn to the realm of hobby shop microabrasives. Specifically, flexi-grit sanding film by K&S Engineering, which begins at 44 microns and goes all the way down to 0.5 microns. Perfect, then, for ensuring the windows are smooth, flat, and as scratch-free as possible. As we work our way through the 5 grits provided with this sanding pack, note how the windows become more transparent each time. That's because, as we move from coarse to fine, we polish out the scratches left by the previous grit and replace them with ones that are far less perceptible. Eventually, we'll wind up with a window that looks like it has no scratches at all. Thank you. And here we are, windows that are once again pretty much see-through. But we're not quite done yet. In order to bring back the shine, I give the windows a quick polish with Scratch-X. That's a liquid polishing compound, used on cars to buff out parts like headlights and lenses to a crystal clear shine. Amazingly, it does the exact same thing when it's used to polish out plastic windows. Listen to that. Squeaky clean. Literally. Anyway, we've got another problem to contend with, and not just my awful puns. All that filling and sanding has made the model look like an airplane, but it's also destroyed quite a bit of the wonderful molded detail that this kit came with. Fortunately, I've got a solution, and a new tool, for that too. This rivet maker. As I push it along the surface of the model, it creates a line of dots to replace the lost rivet detail. This, along with re-scribing the panel lines, helps to bring back detail and realism that I lost during sanding. And once that was done, I could finally bring an end to the weeks of filling and sanding and masking and polishing and riveting and scribing, and start painting, a process which begins with a layer of primer. Maybe it's just me, but it feels like it's taken a lot longer to get to this point in the video than it usually does. I mean, yes, in real life this model did take longer to fill and sand than really any model I can remember, but I promise, things do pick up from here on in. Speaking of, after the primer had dried and I'd given it a light sanding to smooth it out a little, we were ready for the colour coat. The colour of choice? Gloss Aluminium, from Tamiya's line of lacquer paints. I know I'm supposed to be reviewing the model, not the paint, but I will say that Tamiya's lacquer paints are excellent for metallic finishes. They go on nice and smooth, and if you apply them in thin coats, they have this beautiful shine to them, which, in the case of the gloss aluminium, was perfect for replicating the silvery sheen of the Heinkel's fuselage that I saw in reference photos. After I'd finished painting, I left the model to dry overnight. After that, I smoothed out the paint surface by wet sanding it, using some of the 8 micron sanding film from when I polished out the windows. I now had a beautiful silver plane, which only needed a black nose to complete the Lufthansa look. And that's a bit of a problem on the HE70, because Lufthansa decided, quite appropriately, to give their Blitzers a silver lightning bolt down the side of the fuselage. ICM replicates this by leaving the centre of the fuselage stripe clear, which means a little bit more forward planning for me before I can start painting the nose. I decided to solve the problem by creating some paint masks in the shape of the stripe on the nose. I started off by photocopying the decal sheet, then applied masking tape over the stripes, and finally cut them out to give me a way of preserving the silver paint under the stripe. Once I'd applied the masking tape to the nose and added some tape to the wings to create the walkway panels, I was ready to start spraying. The instructions in the kit show that the walkway panels are grey, but all the photos I've seen show them in black. I haven't been able to find a photo of this specific aircraft, so I'm just trusting my references here and hoping they're right. I'd forgotten to mask off the wheel wells earlier, so I had to respray them in RLM-02. Once I'd finished painting, and repainting, the model, I gave everything a gloss clear coat to protect the paintwork and provide a smooth surface for the decals. speaking of decals, I started off with two of the biggest, the stripes on the side of the fuselage. Perhaps I should have started somewhere else though, because the fuselage stripes were an absolute pain to apply. The decals are pretty thin, which is good when you're trying to get them to conform to surface details, but not so good when you're trying to get a big decal like the fuselage stripes off the backing paper and onto the model. That's because the decals had a tendency to fold in on themselves or get stuck in places where they shouldn't, and because they were so thin, they were incredibly brittle. And if you didn't get every last droplet of moisture out from underneath them, they'd tear off if you so much as looked at the model wrong. But that being said, I only ever had problems with the fuselage stripes. The rest of the decals went on perfectly fine with barely any issues to report. I guess because the stripes were long and narrow in shape, there just wasn't enough decal film around the design to reinforce it as I moved them around the model. Anyway, to cut a long story short, I spent about half my decal application time being frustrated by the stripes, and the other half being amazed by how well the rest of the markings went on in comparison. For the registration markings on the wings, I found it was easiest to work from the inside out. That made it easier to line everything up and keep the spacing as equal as possible. In order to get the decals for the tail to conform properly, I found it necessary to slice them in two along the line for the rudder and use plenty of setting solution to stick them down. It's important to use a sharp blade when cutting decals. That ensures a cleaner cut and less risk of tearing the decal to pieces when you slice. One last thing to note regarding the decals. Decal number 16, which is a black stripe, wasn't actually included on the painting and marking diagram. If you're wondering where that goes, it's here, on the bottom of the fuselage. I spent a bit more time working on the decals, but for the sake of brevity, let's just say that once all the markings, big and small, were in position, and the black paint was touched up around the forward stripes, I was ready to flip the model over and get started on the landing gear. And boy, was the landing gear an adventure. See, ICM provides four finely moulded parts that go together to form a reasonably detailed representation of each landing gear leg. But the instructions cram this rather complex assembly into one step and provide barely any explanation of how the parts actually go together. So I abandoned the instructions and relied on guesswork instead. Here's the solution that I found to work. Step 1, glue the shock absorber, part A16, in place. Once that's secure, add the landing gear leg, part B18 or 19 depending on the side, on top, axles facing out. I recommend using super glue to attach parts from here on in, because you'll need them to go together almost instantly. Anyway, once the landing gear leg's in place, add the strut, part A18 or 19, onto the wheel hub at the end of the landing gear leg. Once you've got all the parts together, it should look like a three-sided pyramid. And once those three parts are secure, all that's left to do is bend the landing gear door so that it's at a 90-degree angle, and carefully slide it into place on the wheel hub. And of course, repeat all that for the other side. Once the landing gear was in place, I decided to weather the wheel wells with a dark brown wash. This was the only weathering I decided to do for this model, as all the photos I've seen of Lufthansa's HE70 fleet show them to be spotlessly clean. While I waited for the wash to dry, I added the radiators and antennas to the underside of the aircraft. It's worth pointing out that you need to paint and apply the black stripe decal to the underside of the aircraft before you attach these parts. I also attached the tail wheel, which, by the way, is part B26, not B27 as the instructions called for. After everything was dry and in place, I gave the model a protective coat of gloss clear. I had to be careful not to get my clear coat in the wheel wells, which had to remain matte. While I waited for the clear coat to dry, I painted the tyres in NATO black. The wheels in this kit are nicely detailed, with only a few small mould lines that had to be sanded down before I could paint them. After the wash dried, I began work on the propeller assembly by gluing the nose cap, I guess you could call it, in place. Just like the windows from earlier, this was an extremely tight fit. So tight, in fact, that I was worried I'd split the fuselage trying to get it in place. But once I wrestled it into position, I could now make sense of the five, yes, five, parts involved in the propeller assembly. I started off by gluing the propeller blades to the hub. And then attached the black aerodynamic spinner onto that sub-assembly. Once the glue was dry, I slipped on the first washer. This one doesn't get glued in place, but the one behind it does. If you're careful with the glue, this complicated sub-assembly should allow the propeller to rotate. Unfortunately, I wasn't careful enough, so the propeller on my Blitz is completely rigid. Still, that lack of rotation made it slightly easier to paint the backside of the model's propeller blades in black. Lufthansa did this on the real AG-70s to cut down on glare, and avoid having their pilots blinded by the sunlight reflecting off the shiny aluminium blades. With the propeller assembly glued in place more thoroughly than even ICM anticipated, we're on the home stretch. So I attached the wheel hubs into the wheels, glued the wheels themselves to the model, and then finished off the build by attaching the ailerons and flaps. Because these parts are separately fitted, you can pose them any way you like. I wanted my Blitz to look like it was ready for takeoff, so I kept the ailerons level and glued in the flaps at an angle to show them as being lowered. That's it for the build, so let's get down to the review while we wait for the glue to dry. Let me just start off by saying that the moulding quality of this kit was excellent. As I mentioned at the start of the build, the 69 parts in this kit were really nice, with beautiful surface detail and minimal flash or mould seams to clean up. That's why they've earned a 5 out of 5. The instructions, unfortunately, weren't nearly as good as the parts in the kit. I think they should have gone into a lot more detail than they actually did, especially with complicated sub-assemblies like the propeller and landing gear, and that the diagrams provided should have been far more clear. In some cases, the location of parts and sub-assemblies was completely obscured due to the amount of information crammed into such a tiny space. That said, the parts guide at the front was pretty helpful, especially given the fact that the sprues themselves didn't have any numbers on them. But on the whole, I didn't really find the instructions as helpful as they could have been. Which brings us to ease of construction. This wasn't easy to construct, unfortunately. In general, the sub-assemblies fit together pretty well. But when it came to combining them together, there were a whole host of fit issues to contend with. That's why I have to give it a 2. And considering the amount of filling and sanding I had to do on the fuselage, you might even argue that that was being generous. Anyway, let's talk about the decals. These I can sum up as being hit and miss. The registration letters on the wings, hit. The fuselage stripes, miss. The decals being thin enough to willingly conform to surface details, hit. The decals being so brittle that they broke up as you tried to get them into position, miss. So, in view of the fact that they were really good and really bad all at once, I'll give them a 2.5. And that brings us to value for money, and a more positive note to end this review on. That's because my kit only cost me $21 Australian. That works up to about $14.50 in the US or $12.90 in Euros, excluding shipping, naturally. That's pretty good value for a kit of an airliner from the 30s, but in fairness, Revell offers the military version of the HE70, which is a reissue of ICM's kit, for only €8.49, or $13.82 in Australian dollars. So, those scores together give us a total score of 14.5 out of 25, which, in other words, is just about average. If you're interested in the subject matter, and you've got the skills to overcome the kit's flaws, give it a shot. If not, well, there's no harm in finding something else to build. On the leaderboard, this kit comes in just shy of Italeri's MiG-29. I reckon that if ICM improved the parts fit and added more detail to the instructions, this kit would certainly be more accessible to average or even beginner modellers. I've got to say though, that despite the kit's problems, I'm proud of my little Blitz. After all the work I put into it, it feels like part of myself is in that kit, which may be a real possibility considering how many times I got super glue on my fingers. Anyway, I hope you liked the video and maybe even learnt something. Let me know what you thought down below, and be sure to subscribe if you want to see more videos like this. So, till next time, happy modelling, and now, for your viewing pleasure, ICM's Heinkel HE70 Blitz in 1-70 second scale.